This year's solar eclipse had a path of totality right through Dallas, Texas, and so many people showed up. Unfortunately, I had to observe from about 1,000 miles away, and it was well worth it, as you'll see shortly. In 2017, I was up in Oregon riding the path of totality, and it was amazing. Look at the excitement and how dark it gets. Wow. Solar eclipses occur every few years, and if you want to be in the path of totality, you may have to travel. The next one in the US will be in August 2045. That's what, 21 years from now. So stay healthy and eat your veggies, and who knows, you may get to see it from your backyard. This is what I saw from Las Vegas, about 1,000 miles away. The moon covers about half of the sun, and because there were sunspots on the solar disk, I was able to align the images and create this time lapse. Wow, this is incredible. And in a little bit, we'll do some analysis. We are going to calculate the speed of the sun against the stars, or the sidereal velocity. How? There's no stars in this image. Well, a few days after the eclipse, I calculated the speed of the moon against the stars. So by using the moon versus the sun and the moon versus the stars, we can calculate the sun's velocity against the stars. Huh? Say what? Don't worry, it's quite simple. A graphic is worth 1,000 words. Here's the graphic. So we will measure the velocity of the sun against the stars by comparing it to the velocity of the moon, and we'll get the velocity of the moon relative to the stars. I enjoy photographing the crescent moon with a long exposure time so I can bring out the earth shine. There's something about it, it's so amazing. And so I put together a time lapse for you. Here it is. The moon was photographed through a telescope, high resolution here. Notice the stars in the upper right, how they move relative to the moon. It's actually the moon moving relative to the stars, but I'm tracking the moon here. So let's do some calculations and look at how much the stars have displaced. So I overlapped two of those images, and in the upper right we can see the two stars. I measured the distance d, and I overlay that over the moon, so it's about 2.4 times that distance. And then we have the times, very simple. So we get if you look at the calculations in the lower right, the travel time for one diameter is 2.4 times 24 minutes, that's the difference of time, equals 57.6 minutes. So it takes 57.6 minutes to travel one diameter. And then the second calculation, well, okay, we know the diameter is about 0.5 degrees, so how long would it take for the moon to go around 360 degrees and come back to the same spot, which would be a lunar month? A sidereal lunar month, actually, because the synodic is a little bit longer. So, you know, it's approximate. The sidereal is about 27.3 days, and the synodic, I think it's 29 point something. The synodic is the time from new moon to new moon, and obviously that depends on the sun, which also moves. That's why there is a difference. on. Let's have a look at the solar eclipse. So I put together a few photos and notice it's about 80 minutes to travel one diameter. That is, the moon overtakes the sun and moves about one diameter relative to the sun in 80 minutes. Okay, so now we can do the calculations. Let's have a look at what I've done here. So the velocity of the moon relative to the sun is 0.5 degrees per 80 minutes, so that comes out to about 0.00625 degrees per minute. Then from the previous work, velocity of the moon relative to the stars is 0.00869 degrees per minute. And then over on the right, now we can calculate the velocity of the sun relative to the stars is one minus the other. So 0.00244 degrees per minute. So how fast is that? Let's do some calculations. Here's what I got, folks. Just crazy. I get 102 days. Wow. What the heck? The sun is really going fast. It's supposed to take its time, 365 days. Slow down there, buddy. What's going on here? Well, this is what's going on. The observer is moving as well. That's me. Since I was on the surface, the surface is rotating. In fact, everything is moving from west to east. That's how the Almighty started things rolling. West to east. The sun goes that way, the moon goes that way, the surface goes that way. And of course, I'm talking about motion relative to an inertial frame of reference. Because, as we all observe, relative to us rotating, everything moves to the west. Okay, let's just break this down with this graphic, okay? We already know what the velocity of the sun is relative to the stars. We can calculate it. 360 degrees divided by 365 days, 24 hours, 60 minutes. Look in the upper right, we get 0.00685 degrees per minute, okay? And then we label that right where the sun and the moon is. You can see the arrows to the left. These are sidereal motions. The celestial bodies are moving against the stars, okay? And the farther they are out, the slower they move relative to the stars, okay? And of course, you can tell the moon is closer because it's obscuring the sun, and it's a solid body, opaque, and it's blocking the light, all right? Now, the difference between the two is 0.008. Just round it down a little bit. Okay, and in 80 minutes, the moon should have traveled 0.65 degrees, okay? But that's a little more than the diameter of the sun and the moon, which is 0.5. So we've overshot by 0.15 degrees. And that's because the surface moved and the observer, which is me, moved in that direction, kind of moving the moon back a little bit, retarding it, okay, because I'm moving in the same direction with it, right? And so we have that 0.15 degrees. So now let's use that further to do some interesting calculations here. We'll first need to break down the composite motion, as you see in the lower right inset. Okay, everything moves, but we can break it down like this. Now, this is where it gets really exciting. Okay, so what I'm drawing here is case one. Heavens are fixed and Earth moves. Okay, we can break down motion like that. So we advance a distance A at the bottom between time one and time two. We've moved. There's an angle, 0.15 degrees, okay? And then, once we've done that, we can start creating some equations. As you see in the inset. Okay, first equation at the top, A equals dm 0.15 over 0.5. Okay, 0.5 is the angular size of the moon. Okay, and we take that ratio. And now we have the distance A is 0.3, the diameter of the moon. All right. If you need to spend more time on this, pause the video and think about it. Okay, second equation, the velocity that's perpendicular, as you can see in the graphic on the ground, I broke down the V, the absolute velocity VR into two components, perpendicular and parallel. And we know it took 80 minutes, so it's 0.3 over 80 times dm. Now there's also some angles, and I've measured the angles. I put a line outside on the cement when I made the observations to know where the moon was, and it was about 120 degrees from the north per the compass. So phi is actually relative to the direction towards the east, okay? So 30 degrees more than that. So we have angle phi, the angle phi there, we'll use it. And now we get the awesome result, the velocity at the location where I was at is 0.45 per hour times dm. So if we know the, you know, the diameter of the moon, then we can calculate what velocity we have. Quite awesome that we can do these calculations if we apply a little bit of brain power. But I want to do something a little bit different here and clever. We can relate the diameter of the moon to a distance on the ground. Isn't that incredible? Labeled R, the distance from the center of rotation of the surface. And we know it rotates, we know how fast, okay, we have an angular velocity. But we don't know R, okay? So we'll express this in terms of R. We'll solve the two equations, and there you go. We can relate dm, diameter of the moon, to this distance R on the ground. Isn't that incredible? Okay, now let's make some predictions. This is the fun part here, okay? So at the top on the right, we have a globe model, okay, Las Vegas, 36 degrees latitude. We're calculating R, the distance normal to the axis of rotation. And up top, I have the equations all calculated out. And that predicts a diameter of the moon of 1,858 miles. Okay, now at the bottom right, we have the azimuthal map, which is accepted as the flat Earth map. And there we use R, but what is R? Well, for that map, R is actually the distance, the arc length across the globe, as you see in the top picture. I drew it there in blue. Okay, and it's very simple to calculate. We have 54 degrees. We convert that to radians by multiplying by pi over 180. And then we multiply with the radius. So that gives us the arc length. And then we multiply by that 0.58. And voila, we get 2,164 miles. So now here's the moment of truth. Which value is more accurate? Look at that. We are so close. The flat Earth model wins, folks. Look how close it is. Just 5 miles off. Incredible. Just incredible, folks. But why is that? Well, if you've been following my channel, you know why. There's refraction, and we've let that refraction fool us. The radius of this of the Earth is not correct. From a globe perspective, it kind of makes sense for the Earth to be much bigger so that the proportion of the planet to the moon is more like Jupiter's and Saturn's. proportions. Isn't that interesting? Why should the Earth have a gigantic moon relative to its size? It doesn't make sense. But how large is the Earth, really? You'll find out soon enough. Stay tuned. Thanks for watching, everybody. If you've enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe. God bless. See you in the next video.